Men's study, we talked about getting a board up. We're in the process of doing that. We're going to get a board up so we can get some way for people to communicate their needs. That we're working on that. The board is coming, so I'll give you more on that next week. In Pastor Wayne's absence, like for instance right now he's on vacation, anytime he's gone on vacation or whatever the reason may be, if you have some type of a pastoral need, I mean, God forbid there would be some type of major tragedy, or maybe you just need, for whatever reason, to speak to a pastor immediately, Pastor Tinsley from Bethel Church has agreed to be our on-call pastor. If you ever need a pastor at Pastor Wayne's absence, you can call Bethel Church, you can call Pastor Tinsley at his home after hours. If for some reason you can't get a hold of him, call me, and I'll do my best to get a hold of him. Just letting you know that you do have an on-call pastor for those days when Pastor Wayne is away and unavailable. And Pastor Wayne sent me a note asking me to, I'm going to back up. There's one thing I've got added to my list. David Bassman is back in the hospital. He had a setback yesterday. He's got some fluid on his lungs. He's in Memorial Hospital, and they're telling him this may be a long stay. And you remember what he went through before with his situation at the Veterans Hospital. He does not like laying in these hospital beds for long periods of time, so please, he asks that we pray for patience that he can get through this. We don't know what long stay means. We don't know how many days or how long that means, but just pray for patience. Pray that they will take care of the problem and he'll be able to get back home soon. But he's at Memorial Hospital. If anybody wants to look him up, you can call Memorial Hospital and get those details. All right, then from Pastor Wayne, he wrote me this on Thursday, and he says, please thank the church family for the prayers for my brother Tom. He just got out of surgery and went in at 6 p.m. yesterday. He wrote this to me on Thursday, so that means Wednesday. The surgery went well, and liver is already functioning. And he updated me after that and said that they had removed tubes from him. His breathing tubes were taken out, and it looks well. And that's the last update I got from him, and that was on Thursday. So prayer is answered, and it looks like he's on the mend. And then Pastor Wayne said I should remind everyone of the special service we have for July 4th, which is actually July 3rd. It's sort of a patriotic theme. Brooke has a patriotic choir going on. Also, to prepare your hearts and minds for worship, would you read Psalm 33 before next Sunday? And also, we're looking for a volunteer to read Psalm 33. So if you're willing to come up here and read Psalm 33, Pastor Wayne's gone, so you can't communicate with him. Let me know if you're willing to do that, and we'll pencil you in for that. So Psalm 33 for next Sunday. Another thing, the order of worship today is on a sheet over there. Brother Tom, would you see to it that everybody has one? And, the couple songs we're going to sing today are on there, so you need to have one of those in your hand. And someone mentioned something that really makes a lot of sense. I've been kind of begging everybody to check the board for refreshments. We've been having trouble getting people to sign up ahead of time for refreshments. Someone said, why don't we just put the refreshment thing on hold for the summer? That doesn't mean we can't fellowship. We can still fellowship. But we've got treats out there today. If you feel the Lord moves you to bring some treats, okay, that's fine. But we're just not going to do the sign-up thing. There'll be some weeks when we won't have refreshments. Some weeks we might have a few cookies. But that's okay. We'll still do our fellowship time. And one last thing to mention is that Nancy had successful surgery for carpal tunnel, so prayer of thanks for that surgery. I'm glad she's doing well. Is there anything else anybody wants to announce today? Anything that I missed? Anything to mention? Let's stand and have a word of prayer. Wonderful, glorious Father in heaven, we thank you for this worship day here today. We want you to know that our hearts and our minds are open to you. Holy Spirit, we pray that you'll fill us with your truth. All that we do here today, Lord, is for you and about you. May our words be pleasing to you. Father God, may that your Holy Spirit speak to us through the lips of Kyle today, and please bless us all as we worship you on this day. It's in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, we pray. Amen. Would you greet your brothers and sisters this morning?
Good morning. Page 43 in your hymnal.
Come to you as a congregation with our request. We pray especially at this time for David Bassman, as he is back in the hospital with fluid on his lungs. We pray, Lord, that you be with the doctors as they put him on a new medicine to try to clear this. And we pray, Lord, that you would be with him and give him patience. Just mightily be with him. He gives great testimony of his faith and may have opportunity for that, but that you would just heal him and bring him back and restore him to health. Lord, we pray with thankfulness for the successful surgery that Nancy had on her breast this year week. Pray, Lord, that you would help her to regain the strength that she needs there, and that you would not give her that without the pain that's been there. Lord, we just praise you for what you have done with Pastor Wayne's brother Tom. But in such a need and such a weakened condition for a liver transplant, that in your time you provided, and that the surgery went well, and that even when shortly after the surgery, they knew already that the liver was already helping his body. So we ask that you continue to strengthen him, continue to be with him, and to strengthen his faith in you that you will provide. Father, we pray for this church family, that you would protect us in every which way. We think of, especially of individual families. We think of young families, that, or families that have young children, that they would raise them up to serve, to know you. And we pray for those of us that are older that do not have young kids in our families anymore, but that we would set a good example that they may follow. Father, we pray for this congregation, that you would continue to have us grow in the knowledge of your word, that you protect us from all enemies, that you may give us faithful, that we may be faithful to the mission of spreading the gospel, that as a unit, we are together as one body in Jesus Christ as they have. Father, we pray for Pastor Wayne and Amy and their family as they are on vacation, that you would give them relaxation and refreshment, that you would give them traveling safeties and bring them back to us, restore, and ready to continue their work with us. We ask now that you would be with Kyle as he leads us in worship. Holy Spirit, may just fill him, give him the words that we need to hear this day. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, we'll have an offering collected. Thank you.
Please be seated. When Kyle was a little boy, he was going to be a comedian. And I thought as a parent, that fits. He still does have a neat sense of humor. But, you know, he got a little older and that wore off. And he says, I'm going to be a school teacher. Okay, now we're getting better. I thought as a parent that he can go somewhere with that. That's good. And he got a little older and that wore off. And then he said to me, I'm going to be a politician. And if you know me, I love talking politics. I thought, my son's going to straighten the world up. Yeah, this is going to be great. And in fact, he went to school. He got a degree in political science. So he's all prepared for that. One day, Kyle came to me and said, Dad, I don't remember the exact place I was standing, but I remember the moment so well. Don't remember where we were. But he says, Dad, I've been ignoring God for too long. And I know Kyle is a very good, young, godly man. And I thought to myself, I think I said aloud to him, what do you mean? You've been ignoring God, what do you mean? He said, God has been calling me to go into the ministry, and I've been ignoring him. It's time for me to do it. And I'm going to explain my feeling. It's kind of like, imagine your son coming up to you and saying something like, I just got drafted by the Green Bay Packers. Honestly, and it greater than that even. That's just the closest analogy I can give. What a heartwarming feeling as a parent. Don't we all want our children to do well? And I'm so grateful to have a son like Kyle. I really am. And I'm looking forward to what the Holy Spirit says through Kyle right now. Kyle, God bless you.
Thank you. Thanks, Dad. Well, I had the opportunity to speak on the message and the passage of scripture I'm going to be talking about today to a group of ladies over at Elmbrook Church in Brookfield. And they recorded it and they put it online. So I asked my dad, I said, hey, could you send this link to Pastor Wayne? And I said, you know, I'd like for him to listen to it and give me pointers. You know, what can I do better? What did I do wrong and such? And then about 2 days later, he emailed me and he said, yeah, Pastor Wayne's wondering what you're doing June 26th. I was like, oh no, I wasn't looking for that, but what a blessing it is to be here. I'm really thankful for it. But before you, but sometimes watching the news or reading articles online can be depressing. You guys ever feel this? I'm not talking about the election, just don't worry, I'm not going to go there. But all this talk about persecution, this talk about what the church is going through around the world, we hear things about ISIS and ISIL and the Muslim Brotherhood and all these different governments that suppress Christianity and persecute our brothers and sisters because of it. And if you're anything like me, sometimes it can be hard to grasp because we're so blessed to live in a country where it does happen, don't get me wrong, but that we don't really have to worry about being physically persecuted for our faith. We have that freedom. What a blessing that is. But sometimes it's like, I don't really know how to grasp it. So sometimes I don't know how to react to it, if I should be mad or if we should just pray or what this reaction should be. But as we look into Scripture, what we'll see, thankfully, God knew that we were going to have this question. Because he actually put this in Scripture, and he made an example of Paul, who went through these things. And don't worry, your bulletins are correct. I am going to be talking about the book of Acts. But first, we got to go backwards before we can do that. Because we have to understand the correct context of what Paul was in here. We have to understand what was going on. And to do that, we have to go back to Genesis, believe it or not, in order to figure out how to understand what Paul is going through here. And then to understand what happens when you don't figure out the correct context, I'm going to give you a little story. So I hope you all are awake. Did you have your coffee this morning? So there is going to be a quiz. I'm going to ask a question. It's not rhetorical. I'm going to ask for a question. So make sure you're listening. I'm going to dive right in here. There is a man, and he ran away from home. He ran and ran and ran. And after a little while, he turned left, and he kept going and going. He didn't stop. He actually picked up speed, almost like he was running for his life. And he kept going, and he turned left again. And he kept running and running and running. People are watching him do this. And he keeps going, and then he turns left again. Well, as you can see, left, 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 he pretty much just made a circle. He's on his way back home. And upon returning home, he sees two men wearing masks. So my question to you this morning is, who are the two men wearing masks? Anybody have any idea? If you know this, maybe give it a second, just repeat the thing. Does anybody have any guesses?
Umpire and the catcher.
There you go, the umpire and the catcher. Well, we'll be hearing that for the next 2 minutes, right? Oh, that's. Well, no, if I didn't get the correct context, some of you might have been thinking a robber or something like that, right? A thief in the house. But that's what happened. If I would have told you such a simple story and I said, I'm about to tell you a baseball story, then you guys would have known right away, right? You don't have to be a baseball fan, and you know that I'm a catcher and umpire there. So that's why I'm going so far back in order to understand this. So turn with me to Genesis. Genesis chapter 12. Just as we sang about, we're about to see God's faithfulness here. Turn to Genesis chapter 12, verse 2. If you've been with the church for a while, you probably know this story. It's a very important story to our faith. And if you're new to the faith, this is great because this is important to hear. God speaks to Abraham, and he calls Abraham out of his life. And he says, Abraham, I have a plan for you. I have something I need you to do. You need to leave your household and your father and everything that you know, everything that you're holding on to, and I have a mission for you. And before Abraham says yes or no, before Abraham gives any inkling if he's going to do it or not, God makes a promise. And he makes a covenant with Abraham. And this is where we're going to start. Genesis chapter 12, verse 2. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. So God promises that Abraham is going to receive a blessing. He's not just supposed to hold on to it, keep it for himself, but to spread that blessing and to give it away. He's supposed to be a blessing to others. And all peoples on earth are going to be blessed because of this. All peoples. All people groups are going to be blessed because of this. And what we're going to see is we're going to see Paul picking up on the end of this covenant. That's what we're going to see. But to give you a little bit of background, what happens is Abraham has a son. His name is Isaac. And Isaac has a son whose name is Jacob. And Jacob becomes Israel. And Israel becomes God's chosen people. God chooses Israel to be a mediator between all other nations on the earth and God, so that people can have a right relationship with God. And Israel was supposed to be the priestly nation to the other nations to connect them with God. And as we read throughout the Old Testament, Israel fails at this. And they don't do such a good job. And God keeps sending prophet after prophet to remind them of this mission, that all nations are supposed to be blessed. And prophets keep coming and then they don't listen. In fact, it got so bad that by the first century, when Jesus comes, we see that the word Gentile, which is another word for someone who's not Jewish, the Gentile is a dirty word. You don't want to dine with Gentiles. You didn't want to utter the word because you just didn't want to associate with them. The message got so backwards. It was crazy. What happened was, God shows his faithfulness though. Right? God is faithful. And he sends Jesus. And regardless of what the Israelites did, Jesus comes. And now he is the perfect mediator between everybody and God. Amen? Right? What a great blessing. So God, even though we didn't hold our end of the bargain, God still held his. And he showed his faithfulness. And Jesus, right after his resurrection, before he was about to ascend into heaven, he tells his disciples, he says, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations. All nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them all that I have commanded you, and surely I'll be with you even to the very end of the age. Jesus wasn't making a new promise. He was simply attaching to the one that was already promised to Abraham. He was saying, go to all nations. And this is where Paul is at. Because right after Jesus makes that promise and he ascends into heaven, guess what the disciples do? They pretty much stay around Jerusalem. And then they stay there for quite some time. They stay around Jerusalem. Sure, the message spreads, of course. I mean, obviously, someone just raised from the dead. The message spread pretty quickly. It got to Judea and the countryside and such, and a little bit to Syria. But it stayed pretty centralized for the most part. And so Jesus, again, shows his faithfulness. And he says, Paul, or Saul at the time, his name is Saul, he picks him up and calls him into leadership. And the most unlikely person, one of the people who hated the Gentiles, the person who was killing them and killing people of the way of Jesus, because he didn't believe in Jesus at the time either, the most unlikely person, he says, you're going to be the guy. He says, other people aren't fulfilling this mission, but I need it done. You're the guy. So he sends him off to the Gentiles. And now Paul, after going to all these different churches, as we read in his different letters, Ephesians, Ephesus church, and Colossians, and all these different places, he's now returning back where we're going to pick up. So now turn with me to Acts chapter 21, as we're going to get started. This is where we're in. So now Paul is trying to help fulfill this mission, that all nations will be blessed. And he's going to the Gentiles. And he's returning back to tell his brothers and sisters in the Lord what has been going on. So now, in Acts chapter 20, I'm just going to read this quick. Acts 20, verse 22. Listen to this. "And now, compelled by the Spirit, I'm going to Jerusalem, not knowing what will happen to me there. I only know that in every city, the Holy Spirit warns me that prison and hardships are facing me. However, I consider my life worth nothing to me, if only I may finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying to the gospel of God's grace," or spreading that blessing, the blessing of salvation to all nations. So Paul is so sold out to this mission now. He was so sold out at persecuting it at first, but now he's so sold out, he says, "I don't care if I'm persecuted for it. I'm going to fulfill this mission. I'm going to be a part of this." And he's excited about it. So Paul, by the Spirit, we hear, is going to Jerusalem, right? He says, by the Spirit. Now listen to this. In Acts 21, verse 10. "After we've been there a number of days, a prophet named Agabus came down from Judea. Coming over to us, he took Paul's belt, tied his own hands and feet with it, and said, 'The Holy Spirit says, in this way the Jews of Jerusalem will bind the owner of this belt and will hand him over to the Gentiles.' When we heard this, we and the people there pleaded with Paul not to go up to Jerusalem. Then Paul answered, 'Why are you weeping and breaking my heart? I am ready not only to be bound, but also to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus.' When he would not be dissuaded, we gave up and said, 'The Lord's will be done.'" So we see here that the Spirit gives both groups of people the same message, right? Paul hears from the Spirit that he's going to go to Jerusalem and receive hardships and prison. And one of the elders that he's with and the prophets that he's with say, he says that he'll be bound and thrown into prison by the Gentiles. So we see here that the Holy Spirit gives the exact same message to both people, right? The thing is, though, is their interpretation of it is a little bit different, right? So what we see with Paul here, and what we see his reaction is to persecution, is this. Persecution does not equal stop. Right? Persecution does not equal stop. The others heard the message of persecution and said, it equals stop. They said, "Paul, don't go, you're going to get hurt." Paul doesn't care. Right? That's not in his mind. So persecution is not equal stop. We're going to see this throughout this story as we're going. So pick up with me again in verse 17. Before we start with that, I'll mention too, as people in the church in America, a lot of times it's very easy as well to focus in on the persecution part of the story. And then that's another reason why I went back as well to Genesis, to understand that it's not just about that, but also the fulfilling of the blessing as well. So as we're reading this, we're going to see two main parts. The one is the persecution, and the other is the blessing as well. So let's continue reading with verse 17. "When we arrived at Jerusalem, the brothers received us warmly. The next day, Paul and the rest of us went to see James, and all the elders were present. Paul greeted them and reported in detail what God had done among the Gentiles through his ministry. When they heard this, they praised God." So here they're happy to hear about this mission that's being fulfilled, but then it turns around a little bit. There's a lot of praise, but then it turns the other way. They start to kind of go into reality and continuing to say, "Then they said to Paul, 'You see, brother, how many thousands of Jews have believed, and all of them are zealous for the law. They have been informed that you teach all the Jews who live among the Gentiles to turn away from Moses, telling them not to circumcise their children or live according to our customs. What shall we do? They will certainly hear that you have come.'" Now, this is a lie. This is an exaggeration. What they're talking about is back in Acts chapter 15, if you want to write that down, if you're taking notes, it's very important to read that. It's called the Jerusalem Council. And whether you know it or not, we are living today as followers of brothers and sisters of Jesus. We are living under the decision of the Jerusalem Council, whether you know it or not. What that council was is there was a little bit of debating going on in the early church. And then there was some arguing going on. And what the argument was is that Gentiles were coming to faith in Jesus. Praise God. That's great. But what was happening is they had to decide that they're joining our Jewish brothers and sisters. Do they or do they not? Or should they not be required to have their children circumcised and follow the law of Moses to a T, all the sacrifices and rituals that go along with it? So they're debating, what does this mean? And the end decision was, obviously, as we're living today, was, no, it's not a requirement. The death of Jesus was sufficient for our faith. And then that's all we need is belief in that. And that was the decision. But what the rumors are about Paul is an exaggeration of this. And even though Paul was a part of this Jerusalem council that made this decision, they're saying that Paul not only was saying you don't have to, but that Paul was saying that it is sinful or wrong to continue to follow the customs. And that is not what Paul was saying. To stay embedded in the culture and such is not a bad thing, and to follow the traditions that they were doing. But that's what they were spreading about Paul. So they're saying, listen, Paul, there's these bad rumors going around. If you show your face too much around here, you're dead. So we got to figure something out. If we want this message to spread a little bit, we at least got to keep you alive for a little bit, they're probably thinking. So they continue on here, as we continue in verse 23. So do what we tell you. There are four men with us who have made a vow. Take these men, join in their purification rites, and pay their expenses so that they can have their heads shaved. Then everybody will know there's no truth in the reports about you, but that you yourself are living in obedience to the law. Now, what they're asking Paul to do here is they're asking him to dive head in, head first in the water. They weren't just asking Paul to make sure when Saturday comes around to not work on the Sabbath. It wasn't something easy like that, or to make sure you stay away from pork while you're here. No, they were asking Paul a big thing. What this vow is that they're talking about is actually found in Numbers chapter 6. If you want to read that afterwards, there's this intense vow that people would make between themselves and God. And it was a very dedicated vow where you pretty much cast yourself away from all relationship and such and just became in complete relationship with God. And you'd set it for a certain amount of time and then tell the priest how long you're planning on doing it for. What this involved was you had to first shave your head, like they said. They said join the men in shaving your head. Shave your beard and everything so you had a bare face. And then you were to let it grow as long as you were in this vow to show how long you've been a part of this. And you couldn't touch grapes of any form. So you couldn't drink wine or eat grapes or raisins or anything. And you couldn't be around dead bodies. So the vow is actually so intense, it even says this in Numbers. It says if your mother, your father, or your brother were to die during this, you can't even go to the funeral. That's how intense it is. You can't be around the dead bodies because you have to purify yourself in so many ways and such. So what they're telling Paul is, if we want these rumors to stop, you got to go head into the law and show them that you're okay with this. So they're asking Paul a big favor. And then they also ask him besides to sponsor their sacrifice that they need to do and pay for them. So not only join it, but sponsor the other guys that are doing it. And then they go on to say to confirm the Jerusalem council that they were talking about before in verse 25, as for the Gentile believers, we have written to them our decision that they should abstain from food sacrificed to idols, from blood, from the meat of strangled animals, and from sexual immorality. And these are the things they expected of the Gentiles. So then, Paul's decision, in verse 26, it says, the next day, Paul took the men and purified himself along with them. So he says, yes, anything to spread the gospel, whatever I need to do, short of sin, obviously, wouldn't go there, but anything short of sin I will do to spread the message. And he went into their culture and became one of them again. Even though he was just living as a Gentile in Ephesus, he was just coming from there, but he dives back into being a Jew again to spread the message. And he does this all for the sake of Jesus. Then he went to the temple and gave notice of the date that the days of purification would end and an offering would be made for each of them. So he let the priest know he's going through all the steps. And this is where it really turns around for the bad. This is when it starts to get really exciting. Almost like a drama. I mean, this is crazy stuff. You can't make this up. In verse 27, when the 7 days were nearly over, so he's been in this vow for 7 days now, following it to a T. 7 days were nearly over. Some Jews from the province of Asia saw Paul at the temple. They stirred up the whole crowd and seized him, shouting, men of Israel, help us! This is the man who teaches all men everywhere. Hear the exaggeration? Teaches all men everywhere
against our people and our law and this place. And besides, he brought Greeks into the temple area and defiled this place. And it says in parentheses, it says, they had previously seen Trophimus, the Ephesian, in the city with Paul and assumed that Paul had brought him into the temple area. So more rumors and lies. He didn't actually bring him into the temple, but they just saw him and assumed. So you see how bad this has gotten. All they did is just lay eyes on Paul, and right away they're thinking, kill him. Don't even give him a trial or anything. So this is bad stuff. In verse 30, the whole city was aroused, and the people coming, running from all directions, seizing Paul, they dragged him from the temple, and immediately the gates were shut. While they were trying to kill him, news reached the commander of the Roman troops that the whole city of Jerusalem was in uproar. He at once took some officers and soldiers and ran down to the crowd. When the rioters saw the commander and his soldiers, they stopped beating Paul. And thank God they did. I don't know if you know anything about mob violence, but you don't last very long when you're getting beaten by a mob. A couple of blows to the head and the ribs, and you're going to be out like light pretty soon. So what probably happened is they probably heard the stomping of the soldiers' horses from a distance and saw that, and they thought, oh, we don't want to get put in jail for beating him. And they stopped him. Because otherwise, this could have been the end of the story right here. This could have been the end of Paul. And I wouldn't have anything else to tell you. So it's good to keep going. Alright, and then the commander came up, so verse 33, and arrested him and ordered him to be bound with two chains. Then he asked who he was and what he had done. Some in the crowd shouted one thing, some another, and since the commander could not get at the truth because of the uproar, he ordered that Paul be taken into the barracks. When Paul reached the steps, the violence of the mob was so great, he had to be carried by the soldiers. The crowd that followed kept shouting, away with him, away with him. So the commander made the mistake of asking the crowd what was going on there. The reason that they're mad at him in the first place is it is founded by lies. So of course everyone's shouting different things, different rumors that they believe about Paul, and he can't get to the root of the problem, so he's like, I don't know what's going on. He grabs Paul and they're like, we're going to question him. We're just going to take him into the barracks and see what's going on here. So in 37, as the soldiers were about to take Paul away into the barracks, he asked the commander, may I say something to you? How polite of Paul, right? Just being ripped away from a crowd, asked permission to speak. The commander responds, do you speak Greek? He replied, aren't you the Egyptian who started a revolt and led 4,000 terrorists into the desert some time ago? Nobody knows what's going on here. Nobody has any clue. And then Paul answered, I am a Jew from Tarsus of Cilicia, a citizen of no ordinary city. And then he has the audacity to ask this next thing. He's just getting beaten by a mob, threatened for his life, about to die, and now he's being thrown into a dungeon to be questioned. And he has the audacity to ask this next question. What does he say? He says, please let me speak to the people. I'm asking this to myself. Would I do the same thing? I don't know. I really don't. Like I said before, Paul was sold out on this. Persecution does not equal stop. Right? That was embedded in Paul's heart and in his belief. Persecution does not equal stop. He still had something to say. You know, it can't end like this with me just going to jail. It's like, I gotta ask. Now, we don't know what the conversation was like. It doesn't explain that. We don't know what Paul said to the commander. We don't know if there had to be some convincing or if Paul had to use a bunch of tact in order to do it. Or maybe the Spirit just melted the commander's heart and he said yes right away. Either way, I don't know how it went. It doesn't say that. But the next verse, it says in verse 40, having received the commander's permission. How? We will never know. Having received the commander's permission, Paul stood on the steps and motioned to the crowd. When they were all silent, he said to them in Aramaic, brothers and sisters, or brothers and fathers, listen now to my defense. When they heard him speak to them in Aramaic, they became very quiet. Aramaic was another Semitic language, just like Hebrew, so they're kind of in the same family. So he's speaking to them in a language that they would for sure understand. Again, Paul doing whatever it takes to spread the gospel, speaking their language and being a part of them. And they listen. They're listening to me as a captive audience. And I'm not going to pretend that I'm a better preacher than Paul. So I'm just going to read this to you here. Let's start now in continuing in verse 2. Then Paul said, I am a Jew born in Tarsus of Cilicia, but brought up in this city. Under Gamaliel, I was thoroughly trained in the law of our fathers and was just as zealous for God as any of you are today. I persecuted the followers of this way, the way of following Jesus, to their death, arresting both men and women and throwing them into prison. As also the high priest and all the council can testify, I even obtained letters from them to their brothers in Damascus and went there to bring these people as prisoners to Jerusalem to be punished. At about noon, as I came near Damascus, suddenly a bright light from heaven flashed around me. I fell to the ground and heard a voice say to me, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Who are you, Lord? I asked. I am Jesus of Nazareth, whom you are persecuting. He replied, my companions saw the light, but they did not understand the voice of him who was speaking to me. What shall I do, Lord? Paul asked. Get up, the Lord said, and go to Damascus. There you will be told all the things that you have been assigned to do. My companions led me by the hand into Damascus because the brilliance of the light had blinded me. A man named Ananias came to see me. He was a devout observer of the law and highly respected by all the Jews living there. He stood beside me and said, Brother Saul, receive your sight. And at that moment, I was able to see. Then he said, the Lord of our fathers has chosen you to know his will and to see the righteous one, or Jesus, and to hear words from his mouth. You will be his witness to all men of what you have seen and heard. And now, what are you waiting for? Get up, be baptized, and wash your sins away, calling on his name. When I returned to Jerusalem and was praying at the temple, I fell into a trance and saw the Lord speaking. Quick, Jesus said to him, leave Jerusalem immediately, because they will not accept your testimony about me. Lord, Paul replied, these men know that I went from one synagogue to another to imprison and beat those who believe in you. And when the blood of your martyr Stephen was shed, I stood there giving my approval and guarding the clothes of those who were killing him. Then the Lord said to me, go, I will send you far away to the Gentiles. And there Paul uttered that dirty word, right? The word that wasn't supposed to be spoken. And that's where the crowd didn't continue being so patient anymore, to say the least. Go on to the next verse. The crowd listened to Paul until he said this. Then they raised their voices and shouted, rid the earth of him. He is not fit to live. Now the commander comes back to his senses a little bit and realizes it was probably a bad idea to let him go back out to the mob. So they grab Paul again and throw him back into the barracks. And the commander says to his troops, do whatever you have to do to get truth out of this guy. I don't know what's going on. Flog him, do whatever you have to do, whip him, get the truth out of him. So it says here, a few verses later, Paul was literally stretched out to be flogged. It got to that point. And then Paul says, are you really going to do this to a Roman citizen who hasn't been found guilty? Whoops. they forgot to ask him that. So similar to America, I mean, with some differences obviously, but we have to be put through trial before we can be punished by the government. They had similar laws to protect the Roman citizens as well. So they didn't know that Paul's a Roman citizen. And they questioned him about this for a little bit, saying, are you kidding me? Like, really? The troops won't even listen to the commander. They're backing up and saying, what are we going to do about this? I don't want to lay a hand on them, because otherwise they were going to get in trouble for beating a Roman citizen without convicting him. So they end up letting Paul go. But they say, if we can't do anything about it, we're going to send him to the Sanhedrin. That was the Jewish council, the people who were in charge of all the Jews in Judaism at that time. And they brought him there, and they said, you guys take care of him. You guys do whatever you have to do, but you guys do it. We want to be clean of this. And of course, no good story is good without a cliffhanger. So that's where I'm going to end it there. You guys can keep reading. It's a really interesting story. Paul goes from person to person to different governors being tried over this and spreading the gospel the entire way. It's crazy. Again, I don't know if I would do the same thing, but Paul does. He shows the persecution is not going to stop. So as I was studying this, I asked myself a few questions. And I'd like for you to ask the same thing. Number one is, Who is God placing on your heart to share the blessing that you received? Maybe it's an individual, maybe it's somebody that you work with, maybe it's a friend, it's a family member. But who do you need to share, like God said, the gospel of God's grace to? And maybe for other people, like my wife and I, we are excited about different people groups as well. Maybe it's not individual, but we feel called to maybe do something with different people groups, maybe some ethnicities that haven't had the opportunity to hear Jesus at all. We might be heading in that direction. So we're praying to God and we're wrestling with the idea, does this mean we have to go somewhere? Does this mean we're sticking around and meeting with people of that sort around the area? And we're wrestling through that. But one thing I want you to do this week is just pray. Even if it's once a day throughout the next week, is pray for opportunities. And pray for people you can share this with. And I know God will be faithful and will give them to you. He's not going to leave that prayer unanswered. I have faith in that. So just pray for that over the week. That's the one thing, to share in the blessing that God's given us. We don't just want to keep it. We want to give it away, right? That's the whole point. That's what he said to Abraham. That was the catch. We're going to give this to you, but you got to give it away, right? And next, another question is, when is the last time that you put yourself in a situation that you could be persecuted? When is the last time you put yourself in a situation that you could receive persecution? Now, I want to make clear that I'm not saying that persecution is the goal. The goal is not persecution. Persecution is a negative thing. It's a bad thing. We're not to go out just for the sake of persecution. However, Jesus promises we'll run into it. But I have an example of this. I had a person that I know came up to me and shared a story with me. He was at work. He's a salesman. And his boss was trying to motivate his people to sell more and to get more motivated. So he said, well, what's your higher motivation? What makes you move? What gets you excited? So they were going to write these things on a piece of paper and stick them on the wall so they could remind each other, you know, and motivate each other to, you know, have a good quarter and to do well. So some people shared, you know, I really believe in the product that we're selling. I think it's a great product. I think people could benefit from it. So, you know, I want most people to benefit from this if possible. So the boss wrote it down and stuck it up on the wall. Another person said, you know, I want my kids to have the best education possible. I want to be able to pay for education so, you know, each sale equals more money. I'll be able to send my kids to a better school. I said, great. Kids, boom, put it on the wall. Then it came to this guy that I was talking to. And they said, okay, what do you want us to write down for you? He thought about it for a second. Do I do this? And he ended up paraphrasing Colossians 3:23. And he said, when I work, I don't want to work as if I'm just working for people or just to please my boss. When I work, I want to work as if I'm working for God himself. And I think that if I do well in my work, that I'm actually honoring God through it. That's my motivation. And the boss looked up, said, you're fired. No, he didn't say that. No. Nothing happened. Nothing happened. He said, okay, cool, sounds good. Roll it down and stuck it up on the wall. Now, like I said, you know, in this country, we're blessed that, you know, physical persecution probably won't happen. It does happen. But it probably won't happen. But verbal persecution can happen all the time, right? You talk to some skeptical people and stuff, and people who don't believe that, I mean, you can receive verbal persecution all the way. But this guy bought into the mission. Or the guy that I was talking to bought into Paul's mission, persecution not equal stop. And he shared with his co-workers what was important to him. He was able to witness to them in other ways as well because they found out this was an important thing. So when is the last time that you brought yourself into a situation where you could be persecuted? And then imagine with me, if everybody in the room here were to do, including myself, were to do those two things, to share the message of a blessing, and then to not let persecution stop, and to keep going. Sheboygan County wouldn't be the same, right? If all of us did that. So please join me in prayer. Father, thank you so much for this message. God, thank you for this example that we have from Paul. Persecution does not mean necessarily we should stop. God, I just pray for perseverance for all of us as we live out our weeks over this next week. I just pray that you would give us strength and courage. I pray that you would give us opportunities to speak to people. I pray that the people who we're going to speak to would have a curiosity about what we're about to say, that they would be open to it. And I pray that lives be transformed because of God. I pray that your Spirit would do this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Now I believe we'll be singing hymn number 376, if you want to open to that. Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.